May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. So there is a story of an archaeologist. We'll call him Indiana Jones because that's a cool name. And he goes to Israel and he's in Jerusalem. And he's probably in one of the slightly shadier parts of Jerusalem, the city. And a man comes up to him and he says to the archaeologist, I have found a coin in the desert that I wish to sell to you. And it is made of gold and it is from ancient times. And so the archaeologist is interested. And the man brings him a coin, and on the face of it is Caesar. And just underneath, it's a stamp, 4 BC. And the archaeologist says, well, that's a fake. Excellent. So we know it's a fake, obviously, because, of course, there's no way they would ever stamp a coin 4 BC because of BC stands for before Christ, and you wouldn't, anyway. I love that story. But it's important also because it tells us something about knowing what's going on. Can you imagine some slightly more gullible tourist going, ooh, that sounds great. I think I'd be wanting to buy the coin because that's a nice fake. But you've got to know what's going on. And you have to understand some of the drivers behind what's happening to people. Today we've got two stories of people who are coming to ask Jesus questions. And they're asking questions that are, if you will, leading. So the Pharisees and the Herodians are the first people to ask questions, and they ask the question about the coin. And it's the question they're asking, and let's assume for a moment that it's a real question that's alive in the community at the time, because it probably would have been. Now, they're asking Jesus with ulterior motives, but there's a reason they picked this question. And because it's a question about how do you deal with authority, especially how do you deal with a political authority that's imposing its rules on you. So, not like us, we've got a democracy. If enough Australians don't like the government that we have at the moment, the next time we have an election, they'll vote for someone else. You might like who gets voted for, you might not. But essentially, our system is we, in a sense, make the rules for all of us. That's the system, roughly. For the Jews of the day, that was exactly not the system. The system was the Romans came in, and they were better armed, better trained, better outnumbered the Jews, and so they made the rules for them, literally for their own benefit. And so the question is, do we then pay tax to these imperial masters? Now, if Jesus says yes, then he's supporting them. If he says no, then he's causing, basically he's advocating for a rebellion. So you can see, and this is a live question for them, but they also want to trap Jesus with this same dilemma. And his response is essentially to look at the coins, to recognize that in Jewish law, no graven image, you shall not make a graven image of any object, in the 10th commandment. And he says, look, you've got a graven image on that coin. You don't want it. It's poisonous. Give it back to Caesar. Temple coin has no graven image on it. Not poisonous. Use your own religious law. Give it to Caesar. Return Caesar's poison to him. Return the life-giving stuff to God. Because the idea of the temple, same as in church, the idea is that we give not because we want to maintain the structure, but because we want to maintain the work that is done and the good work that is done. and the structure, and those sorts of things are there to help that. The next question, and I believe Matthew puts these two questions together very deliberately for us. The next question is from the Sadducees. And they are asking a very different type of question. So the Pharisees are asking a question about how do we relate to our political powers of the day? The Sadducees are asking a very different question. They're asking the kind of question I love and most people don't find the point of. They're asking a complex theological question that has no immediate practical impact whatsoever. I love those sorts of questions. I think they're fantastic. And most people look at me and go, I have no idea why you think that's interesting, Andrew. They're actually asking a question about, and it's a very important question for them, because the Sadducees don't believe in any sort of notion of the resurrection. They believe that when you die, end of story. There's no such thing as heaven except for heaven on earth. There's no such thing as a resurrection except for nothing, perhaps your own children continuing your memory. That's their belief. And one of the reasons for this is they go, so much of what is real for us cannot make sense in eternity. And the example is the story that comes from the Old Testament of a woman who, back then, when you married into the family. It was a bit like a mob thing, I suppose. And if your husband died and you didn't have any sons, you got married off to the next appropriate male in the family. Whether you liked them or not, you didn't have a choice. Now, in a sense, that was a good thing because it also meant you couldn't be kicked out and left to starve. The family supported you. So it was culturally very different to what we experience now. So there's a story of a woman, and there's this demon that is kind of plaguing her, and she's managed to work her way through seven brothers before she too finally dies with no heirs. So the question is, in the resurrection, who's she married to? She can't be married to seven different guys at the same time, whom all brother Eve. So there's no possibility for that. And that's the question that the Sadducees are seriously asking. I love it. It's awesome. And Jesus' response is, you don't understand what eternity might be like. Marriage is a kind of a now thing. It's only until you die. Seriously, you only have to put up with the person you married to for max 50, 60 years. And then one of you's going to die. It's a short-term proposition in eternity. God is the God of life and of the living, not of the dead, says Jesus. I actually think both those sorts of questions are questions that we need to be asking in the church all the time. There are questions that we need to be asking constantly about how do we relate in our society to power and authority. Remember, we voted for our politicians, so if we don't like their policies, we should say so. And we should say so with authenticity and integrity. But we should also remember that when we speak as Christians, we are speaking on behalf, in a sense, of God, who is the God of life, not of death. So when our authority figures start to put forward policies that promote darkness, death, putting barriers in place for people to access that which is good, we need to have the courage to speak against that. It's a real question for us. But we also need to be informed as to our own faith tradition. We need to know, to a certain extent at least, these questions that may seem to have no immediate practical impact. Like the question the Sadducees are asking. Because at their core, are the answers that inspire us to live a life that reflects now the eternity that God calls all humanity to. The point isn't the argument. The point is finding truth and proclaiming it in the world. that's what we are called to do and be. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.